Hello, welcome to VMC. I'm Dr. M. Today we are going to be covering how to find and assess what an excellent and ethical breeder looks like. There are way too many people who end up unintentionally supporting puppy mills or backyard breeders, and then they end up with a dog that has way more issues than it potentially would have if they could have had a resource to properly find a breeder who's actually doing a good job bettering the breed. So join me, you'll learn something today. So I guess the first thing is congratulations, you've decided that you'd like to start looking for adding a pet to your family, a dog or a cat, and there can be this urge to really rush and find the quickest addition that you can. And I want to strongly caution you to slow down a little bit and not do that. The first thing that you need to do is to start thinking about what sort of a breed would be the best fit to join your family. Now, there are some things that are somewhat obvious. If you live in somewhere that's hot, you probably shouldn't be getting a Malamute or another Alaskan breed that does best doing a lot of exercise in cold weather. Conversely, if you live somewhere very cold, say even the Northwest Territories or Alaska, you probably should not be looking for a Mexican hairless dog, right? Like, there's just some common sense things that you really need to think about here. But I also want you to think about things like, what is the size of your yard? What is your schedule like? Who will be letting the dog out when you're gone at work for the day? If you're gone from the house for 8 or 9 hours at a time, you're gonna need someone to come and let the dog out halfway through the day for a pee break, freshen food puzzles up, have a little bit of play time, maybe go for a bit of a sniffari, and then back inside the house to wait for the rest of your work shift to end. Can you go home to do that? Will you need to hire someone? Will you need to have your dog go to daycare? What are the costs of these sorts of things? These are all things that you need to think about and problem solve before you add a pet to your house. Also, you need to be thinking about, you know, what sort of a function you want this dog to have. Are you looking for a couch potato because you like to spend a lot of evenings watching Netflix? Are you looking for a working dog because you're heavily into agility? Are you looking to start trying some dock diving? Or, you know, what sort of a hobby do you want to do with this dog? Or is this dog going to be a full-time working companion for you because you have sheep and you need a herding dog? You know, like, what sort of a dog are you actually looking for? And then you can start to consider what sorts of breeds might best suit the lifestyle that you have. If you're someone who likes to run long distances, you probably should not be looking at a brachycephalic breed like a pug or even a dog like a basset hound. You know, those dogs just don't do well running long distances. Conversely, if you live in a small apartment, you should not be looking at a pointer or a Malamute or a Malinois or some sort of dog that really does need hours and hours and hours of work to keep them happy. I will link to some resources that you can take some quizzes to kind of get some ideas of some breeds that might realistically fit into your lifestyle. That's a good place to look if you are fairly new to dog owning or you're just not quite sure where to start. I did also want to note that even within a single breed, you can have quite a spectrum of activity levels. For example, I do have a Labrador, however, her lineage is a hunting working line, and as a result, she takes a good 3 hours of mental activity and enrichment every single day. She doesn't care if it's raining, cold, hot, whatever it is, she requires about 3 hours every day throughout the day in order to keep her feeling happy. There are some that might even require more than my dog if they have been bred to be even more active and more of a working line than the dog that I have. And so it's very important to be realistic about what time commitment you have for your dog before you add one to your family. And when you are talking to breeders, if they are telling you that this line is a pretty active one, then you should be looking elsewhere. So just because a breed quiz might tell you, hey, look at these breeds, it's important to remember that there is going to be a spectrum of appropriate energy levels within a breed. There are three categories of people who will call themselves breeders. The first category that we'll talk about is a puppy mill. And these places have too many dogs in very poor conditions a lot of the time. They aren't doing health testing. They're often selling to pet stores. Do not ever buy a puppy from a pet store that is supporting a puppy mill. Do not ever buy from a place that doesn't let you come to see their place and that is putting out litter after litter after litter after litter after litter. Do not support these guys. People will say, oh, well, I'm rescuing the dog from a puppy mill, but you aren't. What you're doing is increasing the demand for these dogs, and so then the puppy mills produce more dogs to meet that demand. The only way to get rid of puppy mills is to stop supporting them. So you must not support them. These dogs have horrific genetics, they are disasters behaviorally, physically, and they cause so many problems. Next category of breeder is the backyard breeder. These are people who don't do health testing, they don't look into the lineage of their dog or the dog that they are breeding to. It is probably not even a purebred dog. Some people just want one litter for fun or whatever wrong, misguided reasons they have for it. You must not support these breeders either. This is not improving the breed of the dog. This is going to result in puppies or kittens that have unknown genetics, poor genetics, behavioral concerns, and we should not support these either. It's very, very important to support responsible, ethical, and excellent breeders. A reputable breeder is where you want to buy from. These breeders may have a handful of dogs or maybe around 10 dogs, but they are well cared for. You can visit the property, you can see how the animals are cared for, and these dogs are going to be regularly showing, whether it's in confirmation or in some sort of performance event, the dogs are going to be registered through the AKC or the CKC or whatever the reputable registry is near you. The litters are going to have a purpose to them. They're not bred, you know, just because I wanted a litter. It's bred because the breeder is looking to improve temperament, or the breeder is looking to improve conformation in a certain area, or because the breeder is wanting to produce a better sport dog for a specific sport, and they have thought for years and very long and hard about what the best way is to try to produce that litter. These breeders also do all of the health testing that is necessary for that breed. You can check out the AKC. They do have a list of kind of the bare minimum that's required for each breed. You know, that could be a lot of orthopedic testing, like hips and elbows. It could be heart testing, eye testing. It could be various genetic testings. You know, the list goes on and on and on, and it will vary depending on which breed you are looking at. But these reputable breeders test like crazy because they want each litter to be an improvement of the breed, and they are passionate about this, and they spend an awful lot of money doing this. Now, with that cost does mean that there is cost to these puppies. They are going to be $1,000, $2,000, maybe up to $5,000. However, it should be noted that often pet store and puppy mill puppies can even be more expensive than a responsible breeder puppy. Cost is not linked to quality. It's just important to remember that when purchasing a responsibly bred animal, that there is cost associated with that. And it's also important to remember that the cost of buying that animal is only the very beginning of the cost of having that animal join your family. Vaccine appointments, deworming, flea prevention, heartworm prevention, spaying and neutering, puppy classes, sport classes, equipment, kennels, toys, pet insurance. Having an animal is an incredible investment, and before you add one to your family, no matter if you are adopting or supporting a responsible breeder, you need to be prepared for those costs and budget that out first to figure out if it is even possible with your lifestyle, with your budget, to add in an animal to your family. Responsible breeders also care a lot about where their animals go, and they often will be giving health guarantees, and they will want that if something changes, that they have the right to take their animal back from you if you can no longer keep them for some reason. I mean, it should be rare that this happens, but it is possible that in a drastic situation that you can no longer properly care for an animal that you've committed to, and a responsible breeder will take that animal back so that they can find it another excellent home, whereas a puppy mill or a backyard breeder will not be doing that, and so that's something else to look for when you're looking for a reputable breeder. Please comment with thoughts, suggestions, anything that's come up for you as you've listened to me go over all of this information. Make sure that you subscribe if you haven't already. I know from the stats that a lot of people who watch my videos are not subscribed, so if you are enjoying them, please subscribe. Share it with a friend who you know is looking to add a pet to their household. We have to get this information out there. We've got to shut down puppy mills. Join me in doing that, and we'll see you on the next one. Bye! Thank you.